As you may know, most of the world plays EVE on the Tranquility server, whilst Chinese law once required the creation of the Serenity server for people there to play. Here, then, is a little update that straddles both worlds, coming as it does at a time when people have noted an influx of Chinese players on Tranquility. It also serves as something of a tech demo, since although I've been recording in 5K for the past 3 years, we've rarely had 5K grand battle footage making it to YouTube. The low bitrate codec will sadly eat much of the quality on such busy scenes, but for what it's worth, when you see the 5K symbol up, you have MMO's biggest spectacles captured in high fidelity. Now, the notion of a story straddling both worlds has been explored before. In the Message in a Bottle video, we saw how what one might call EVE weapons technology can be exchanged in a very meaningful way between the servers. There's always a great deal of talk in the community, and I suppose the wider media, about the Great Firewall of China. And indeed, all the forces that made the creation of the separate Chinese server necessary in an otherwise single virtual world. So it's interesting that whatever legal and cultural boundaries are imposed, the EVE virus finds its way through. My partner in crime that day, across the divide of the World Bridge wormhole, was my friend Fulcrum, and he is also the chief protagonist today. Admittedly, rather than sending probes across a world bridge, we craft people's doom on TeamSpeak.
Speaking to you via a bridge between worlds.
We became friends many years ago, when Rooks and Kings was at the height of activity, and it gave me a chance to test out our tactics across the divide of language, culture, and regulation. Who would say no? Fulcrum's group was the Pan Intergalactic Business Community, henceforth known as PIBC. PIBC had a lot going for them, which included the brilliant leadership of a man called Military Bun, and a queen in the form of Chen Chen. Chen Chen has more than a small cult devoted to her, and their activities include a weekly comic strip when not busy defending her keep stars. The hierarchy is then rounded off with an FC corps led by Fulcrum, Remoto, and others. Fast forward a few years, and thanks to that group of people, nearly all of Nullsec space on Serenity is under PIBC control. The battles that took them there include the carnage of 49 TAC-U in the spring of 2014, which is to date the bloodiest EVE battle of all time, with a butcher's bill that includes 85 Titans lost. It was the Battle of 49 TAC-U where PIBC finally overwhelmed their long-standing enemy, RAC. The battle between PIBC and RAC has often been compared to the classic struggle between Goonswarm and Band of Brothers in the antiquity era of our Tranquility server. After 49 TAC-U, PIBC established a supercapital superiority that is yet to be truly challenged to this day. Gradually, the wars of conquest became the quelling of rebellions, and the last major uprising I reported on was the Letter War, where once again PIBC prevailed. Before we go on, I should say that being in a PIBC fleet is always an interesting experience, and a big change from the tactical planning sessions with Fulcrum. To my discredit, I'm yet to learn Chinese, and since I play on a Chinese client, the cruel proximity of the open bridge and self-destruct buttons on the Titan is often on my mind. While much of the fleet seem to assume I'm working on the finer points of crafting a strategic initiative, I'm usually just trying to maintain my dignity and not accidentally blow myself up. It turned out, however, that in China, staving off self-immolation is not enough to maintain dignity. One also needs a momo. A momo is a sort of emoji representation of one's inner kawaii, to borrow the Japanese term. You X for fleet, you link your fit, and you link your momo. Building a fine momo was a rite of passage on my adventures in the East. Between us, by the way, since I don't know if I'll upload this video to China, I would like to confess that I'm sometimes suspicious about things that happen while I'm sat waiting to bridge or jump on Serenity. I recall one instance where I asked a scout about the present state of an enemy form-up, or indeed lack thereof. No less than 5 minutes later, an unescorted neutral dreadnought flew through the system from one gate to the other.
You see him?
Despite having a force of several hundred people, it was suggested that I should personally chase down the interloper with my Ragnarok Titan and doomsday him.
Whatever you want. It's yours.
Suspiciously, he failed to react to the massive hippopotamus of a ship bearing down on him, and two gates later, he was indeed DD'd.
Nice!
I have to assume that the moment I made my inquiry, someone somewhere said that the idiot Westerner is bored again, and I imagine an angry general stabbing a finger at some poor orderly and saying, "You, die now," and the poor fellow went and got his dreadnought. Anyway, be that as it may, another interesting fact is that the PIBC forces are usually called mangoes. I initially assumed that this was in some way connected to the fruit, but the first time I raised the issue in fleet, I was immediately convoled by a hostile who'd heard about my question via a spy. Without much preamble, he told me that mangoes means PIBCers are dogs. Well, from furry culture to the dog-headed Saint Christopher, the appropriately evish cynocephaly ought really to be a mark of respect, although on further investigation, the idea was mostly that a dog follows his master. But even that seems okay, in the S&M way, and merits a bit of further digging later. In times of late, the expression of this mastery took the form of Lancer Squad. Lancer Squad is a subset of the PIBC Capital Fleet that was trained by Ramoto and Kaljaz to perfect the application of the Lance and BFG Doomsday. Upon its introduction to the game, the Lance Doomsday was immediately used from the safety of Keepstars. However, Ramoto and Kaljaz wanted something much more dynamic, and set about training their Super Capital pilots to gallivant around the galaxy and perfect the crossing of the beams and BFG application to volley their enemies off the field. The moment a spy hears an anchor point called, or a scout sees an opportunity, they jump in to strike. The advent of these new toys in Eve provided the perfect means for PIBC to leverage their super capital muscle and exert dominance where resistance was still to be found. But recently, the hammer was required somewhere this weapon could not go. And to understand that, we have to turn the clock back a few months. At the end of the Letter War, the Galaxy Alliance, usually known by their acronym TGA, were defeated. In one last roll of the dice, TGA sought to secretly move their capital fleet at odd hours of the Chinese night to craft a trap for PIBC's northern forces. Oversimplification though it may be, one might roughly consider the standing supercapital force of PIBC to be split into two halves to control their vast territory. Control of the north belongs to Chen Chen and her superfleet there, whereas the south falls under the remit of Fulcrum and friends. When necessary, the two halves can combine to strike as one, but this takes a bit of time and preparation. TGA's plan was specifically to ambush the north first, with around 100 Titans and supercarriers in a surprise attack. However, TGA's setup was fraught with difficulty. The war had left their supercapital spread far and wide. For example, their Knight of Freedom Corp had docked their supers in Losek near the Great Wildlands. Their Sword of Northwind's capitals were still around N3 TAC JBX, and the EF Air Force was as far south as GTAC M in Stain. As a result, every labored move was carefully watched by PIBC spies and double-checked with locator agents. Every time TGA telephoned their core group for supercapital moving operations, PIBC did the same. And therein you have the advantage of winning a war. PIBC pilots were out of bed faster, stayed up longer, and probably arrived for work later. Each time TGA formed for a move, little did they know that a PIBC force several times their size was already tracking them with sinos and dictors. Many of their move ops were cancelled or delayed, until finally they attempted a jump into 4M TAC-P in the Great Wildlands, which ironically was my first home system in EVE some 12 years ago. Here, the TGA ambition for supercapital revenge met its demise. Although only one leg of their ill-fated ambush force was destroyed, TGA realized the impossibility of dealing a decisive blow, and they moved to NPC space in Curse and made the OSY station their home. This in itself did not mean the end of resistance, but gradually the PIBC net was closing in, with Remoto happy to drop Lancer Squad onto the station undock, or, as in this case, next door, at HA Dock. TGA was soon joined by other refugees who were pushed into NPC space. During these months, I was often able to join ops with Fulcrum, who would phone me in the early hours of the night. Sometimes PIBC used Lancer Squad, sometimes a conventional supercapital hammer with carrier support, and sometimes even old-school dreadnought drops. But whatever the tools, the result was the same, and slightly apocalyptic. Endless fields of burning ships, husks of capitals, and armies retreating across swathes of Nullsec. An unusual fact of the battles was the high proportion of Serenity's online population who were involved in each one. Rather than have a multitude of battles unfolding across the map at any one time, conflict was tightly concentrated with every PIBC pilot deployed directly and most other online players forming the resistance which met them head on. That had the consequence of the battles being extremely fluid in server performance, and as you see here, hundreds of dreadnoughts could fight and die on the same grid in real time. This scene was one of dozens of the era. On the Tranquility server, there is a tendency for a losing or outgunned side to wage asymmetrical warfare, or to go behind enemy lines with so-called wolf packs and hunt industrial enterprises, or fight by content denial and frustration. Although all these things did still happen against PIBC, there remained a far greater tendency to settle matters in Apex fleet combat, no matter the odds. And so, time and again, the Resistance bravely lined up to stand up, and PIBC formed up to knock them down. The result of all this was to leave the Resistance centered around two focal points, one being the OSY station in Curse, manned broadly by XTGA and allies, and the other being RAC's holdout in NPC Stain. As mentioned before, the RAC versus PIBC struggle on Serenity is similar to that of Goonswarm and Band of Brothers in the formative days of the Tranquility server. From within the walls of their last refuge in Stain, RAC held a meeting of their high command to determine the future of their alliance. Listening in from somewhere in the rafters, Fulcrum recorded every word for me, and what you hear now publicly for the first time in either community are the simple words that ended an empire. The speaker is the legendary Leaf Queen, who had fought to the bitter end.
很极端，我也不想跟 PIBC 打，我也不想跟我们的敌对打，跟谁打我都不乐意。我想拉着所有人没事的时候就在四季扣纪念一下他，然后所有东西物资啥，包括穿梭机我都拿来自爆了。爆完了之后，然后呢，所有账号对吧？所有账号也好，或一系列的资产也好，资产能爆的爆掉，能就是说船我是要爆掉，装备摧毁掉，因为船可以自爆嘛，对吧？然后装备摧毁掉，然后账号可以删除掉，然后处理完了就所有人都是这样操作，操作完就极端的毁掉这款游戏，然后让自己再也没有念想。
It is a good ending. In its fanatical nihilism, it bears a little of the burying of Alaric in the banks of the Bucento River, where the great enemy of Rome told history that of my body and my last spoils.You shall have nothing. And so, for what it's worth, Rooks and Kings salute the Leaf Queen. It's also a very Eve ending for an empire. And although there will come a caveat, much of RAC disappeared right there, leaving behind a fine combat legacy in the history of a virtual world. That left OSY station in Curse.Where many people probably expected a similar meeting with a similar outcome. But when it came to it, something else happened. C.S. Lewis's Narnia world is usually associated with the famous work The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Less well known is the final tome, called The Last Battle,where Lewis's apocalyptic Christian beliefs collide with his rather pagan, fantastical land of talking animals, high kings, and emperors beyond the sea. Ideologically, we might prefer a tome like His Dark Materials, but Narnia serves us well here. In the last battle, the land of Narnia is overrun by a horde from the east and their demon god. The last followers,of the God King, Aslan, the talking lion who forms the centerpiece of Lewis's theology, are pinned down in a stable, surrounded by their enemies. It wouldn't be wrong to say they were literally hell-camped. With his loyal subjects facing oblivion, Aslan opens a portal to another world, and the stable they leave is in fact another stable into another Narnia.Did they die horrifically and are now in Aslan's heaven, the reader is left to decide. Lewis describes the abandoned Narnia behind them as being overrun by darkness and floods, and in time, even the end of time. From what I understand, TGA leader Sky God did not survive the Letter War, but his loyal subjects did. And when they left the Hell Camp of OSY Station, they undocked from OSY Station on Tranquility. Why move server and begin operations from the same station? Who can say, but it certainly adds to the symmetry. Now, I know what you're thinking. Aslan's country is a strange sort of heaven, where you can be dropped 1,488 different ways by Lex Arson or memed by a bee king in a wizard hat. But there's no doubt that for a while at least, the land looked greener than having hundreds of PIBC supers on your doorstep, and behind them the Horde's enveloped serenity. I should add, at this point, that the notion of such a voyage was not lost on the Leaf Queen either, and a good number of RAC pilots also travelled to Tranquility, even though she herself fell on her sword. These dual migrations are the driving force behind the expansion on Tranquility of the Chinese Alliance Fraternity. Since the factions hostile to PIBC had often worked together, the loss of vast swathes of TGA and RAC to Tranquility meant that the remaining resistance was increasingly isolated, and so the purge intensified, with groups like the Southwest Treaty Organization and the Blade of Northwind also forced back and hemorrhaging members to the world in the West. Now, at the risk of laboring our parallel, all the animals were judged by Aslan in that stable, and those found wanting were sent back out into that hostile world and lost their ability to speak. Which is fitting here, since the pilots in Serenity's OSY who didn't follow the ghost of Sky God through the portal decided to move to wormhole space, where indeed there is no local chat. Those Chinese who lived outside of PIBC rule, in wormhole space, based themselves either from Terra or were part of the wormhole alliance called Star Chaser. Who consolidated and fortified their Keepstar system of J124504. And this might well have been the end of our update, with an exodus to Tranquility, PIBC domination on Serenity, and surviving Chinese stragglers and alts retreating to wormhole space. The new Chinese arrivals on Tranquility did well. Basing out of Tranquility's OSY station, they flew for a number of allied groups. One was Fraternity, already established on Tranquility. Another was Ranger Regiment, who are a western reformation of the Serenity Group Southwest Treaty Organization. China Soul Reaper reformed under the same name as on Serenity, and these forces were rounded off with Star Chaser, who also used the same name as their Serenity wormhole incarnation. This burgeoning horde from the east soon made enough of a splash in combat and general activity that this new exodus was widely commented on in the Western Eve community. For their part, many of them still had ties to the Chinese Serenity community, or alts in Star Chaser, and so many videos were released on Bilibili, the Chinese video platform, documenting their adventures and successes in the West. In their output, a strong anti-PIBC sentiment remained, with the notion floated that to be with PIBC was to be against this new invasion of the West. In turn, PIBC command noted that an invasion was itself a matter of perspective, since what some saw as a Chinese beachhead pouring invaders onto Tranquility, PIBC saw as a human train of beaten refugees, snaking endlessly into the horizon and all the way back to the rubble of 49 Tac-U. But there's also a more subtle dimension to this, which deals with nationalism and identity. You must keep in mind, of course, that my sources are PIBC Command, and that PIBC's arguably main FC is also a Rooks and Kings director of many years, and we flew with them before they were the Empire. Since I'm not equipped to trawl the Chinese forums outside of translator tools or having key posts translated for me, I can only speak for the veracity of their interpretation and what it motivated them to do. And they noted that numerous videos from the exiled PIBC enemies stated that anyone against them was fundamentally un-Chinese and a traitor. Addressing other Chinese who might come to the West, including some PIBC who had previously made alts in the Imperium Corporation, PLA, the exiled forces said, "If you roam our space, you are a traitor who hunts his own people." Each month, Fulcrum would tell us of fresh rumors being spread that the Serenity server was ending, and each time the threads were created by PIBC's enemies. The subtext was clear: Serenity was a doomed world, and thereby PIBC with it. It was a Chinese duty to abandon that place and join the exiles in a new war in heaven. Each month, Serenity defied their claim and ticked on, and each month fresh rumors were spread. To PIBC, it seemed that if their enemies could not contest militarily, then they were trying instead to contest on the battleground of Chinese identity. For the exiles to lay claim to the voice of China would also mean that PIBC was un-Chinese, for when it came to PIBC, the exiles demanded that all must be united against their former tormentors. Those who stayed on Serenity now, they said, were traitors who preferred to hunt their own kind, Chinese who turned on Chinese. Fulcrum brought this matter to the rest of PIBC Command, quite willing to play the very villain they'd cast him as, and a suitable response presented itself in the form of an obvious target, namely the Star Chaser Keepstar. After all, Star Chaser were one of the groups living in Tranquility's incarnation of the OSY station, and there was an economic motive too, for Star Chaser's wormhole production was the main source of ever-escalating T3 component costs for PIBC. And so, Military Bun authorized Fulcrum to invade Star Chaser's wormhole and destroy their Keepstar as a matter of principle. But invading the main Star Chaser wormhole proved to be no simple matter. Star Chaser maintained around-the-clock security and were diligent in collapsing any potentially suitable wormholes that PIBC might use. While their projected apex force of 100 carriers might not have presented PIBC with any significant obstacle in K-space, in a wormhole system it represented considerable power, and when combined with Star Chaser's ability to form up an emergency defense fleet, the matter of establishing a beachhead was not an easy one. You're probably thinking, Rooks and Kings used to know something about wormholes. Our French corporation, Guillotine Therapy, ruthlessly hunted J-Space until 2012, when Elm and Curafin became too busy with their business ventures to continue wormhole life, and chose to go out on top and join me in K-Space. Still, we considered wheeling Elm out of retirement, and perhaps the draw of going to J-Space to settle a question of Chinese identity might have been a sufficient draw, but Elm and crew were busy battling the Blood Bowl World Championship. So Fulcrum remained, holding enormous manpower, with thousands of pilots ready and no foot in the door. But if Aslan's barn had made his prey elusive, perhaps it could also be the key to strike at them. And so the solution was for the Hand of Hell to slither out from demon-infested PIBC-run Dark Narnia and follow the Chinese exiles. On Tranquility, Fulcrum made some calls. Stedio from Pandemic Horde, Nex Gaius from Pandemic Legion, 47 from Tactical Supremacy, Yomod from EFCON, and Lieutenant Schwartz from Test Alliance. Quickly, plans were set into motion. Reinforcement fleets were formed, and timers were generated that Fraternity and other groups harboring exiles would have to respond to. It appears that a Rooks and Kings director can still call in a few favors, and so a collection of late 2017 luminaries were assembled for the final IHUB timer, including Pandemic Horde and the Imperium. Test Alliance were vague on whether they would commit, but when the moment came, the Dino Cavalry rolled in. Meanwhile, Darkness and Triumvirate were called in to support Fraternity. The result was a massive dreadnought battle in F-QQ5N, where the Chinese arrivals were forced to bring all hands on deck to hold the line. While all this unfolded, and the Chinese beachhead of Tranquility arrivals were busy fighting to the last man, PIBC took advantage of a lull in Star Chaser activity to establish their own beachhead that night into the Serenity wormhole. Here you see the battle of F-TAC-QQ-5N on Tranquility from the view of a Russian ally, overlaid with the simultaneous wormhole insertion on Serenity and the comms from PIBC's most forward battlegroup, tasked with gaining whole control.
504, 对不对? 勾125,
是的,
还有一条血鬼怪。血鬼快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快过，快
PIBC heavily seeded their wormhole with hundreds of pilots, who then rolled entrances for hundreds more. Given time, could they have done this without any distraction? I suspect so. But Military Bun likes his debt settled quickly. The defenders did have the good fortune of the spawn of a frigate wormhole, which took more time for PIBC to collapse. As they realized what was happening, Star Chaser used this to bring in additional manpower, sourced from all the rebel forces and exiles, who once again activated their characters. Although arriving in frigates, these reinforcements could then freely man ships from the stockpiles in the Keepstar. Leveraging the power of their vast wormhole carrier fleet, this force was able to destroy 150 of Fulcrum's invading force and a staging of Strahus. But PIBC had their foot in the door, and successive alarm clock ops and battles allowed them to bolster their invasion with ever more numbers, until finally Fulcrum had 1,200 pilots inside, an enormity for wormhole space. Star Chaser had no chance. The hordes from hell had breached the gate, and their last surviving capitals tried to warp away from the Keepstar as it burned. Is this truly the end? Unlikely. I believe the likes of RAC will rise again to battle PIBC. And whether they stay united or diverge to different power blocks and causes, I think the new Chinese arrivals on Tranquility will continue to make a name for themselves. If they ever go home, the Mangos will be waiting. Mango. I'd spent quite some time among PIBC, among the Mangos, as it were, before the derogatory root behind that surprisingly English term was explained to me. And, just as one man's invasion force is another's refugee train, so too the term Mango is hurled with anger and worn with pride. What it means, they said, is that where the Emperor points, the man goes.